This program is presented by University of California Television. Like what you learn? Visit our website or follow us on Facebook and Twitter to keep up with the latest UCTV programs.
The speaker today for Grand Rounds is Dr. George Liu, who is an associate professor of pediatrics at UCLA, an associate director of the Infectious and Immunologic Disease Research Center at Cedars-Sinai. He received his MD from University of California, San Diego, his PhD in immunology from the University of Cambridge in England. He completed a residency in pediatrics at Davis and a fellowship in infectious diseases at UC San Diego. Dr. Liu's research is known for the focus on understanding host-pathogen interaction and with identifying novel bacterial immune evasion mechanisms targeting specifically Staph aureus. And the idea is to enhance treatment of infections caused by antibiotic-resistant pathogens. He has served as ad hoc member of multiple NIAID study sections and has been the recipient of several awards, including the American Society of Microbiology Merck Irvin Seigel Memorial Award and the Pfizer Aspire Young Investigator Award. His research has been supported by grants from NIH and Pfizer, and he's published about 40 peer-reviewed articles, chapters, and has participated in various symposia and invited lectures. So the title of his talk today is Community-Associated MRSA and Investigations of Host-Pathogen Interaction. Dr. Liu.
Thank you, Dr. Dabaskar, for inviting me to give Grand Round. It's good to be back here. Can you hear me in the back okay? Okay, today I want to talk to you about a story of a pathogenic strain called USA-300. And USA-300 is an MRSA strain which really came out of nowhere and within about 10 to 20 years has become one of a great pathogen of our time, at least in my opinion. Okay, to start off, we know that Staph aureus is a bacteria that live with us in our nose as a commensal, maybe in one out of three of us. But it is also known as one of these pathogens that causes skin infection that all of us had at one time or another in our life, and also causes more severe infections such as pneumonia, bone infection, bacteremia, and sometimes toxic shock. And when I was a medical student, I was told that at the time, first of all, there's two flavors of Staph aureus. There's the methicillin-sensitive Staph aureus, and then there's the methicillin-resistant Staph aureus. And when I was a medical student, I was told that MRSA only existed inside the hospital, especially in places where there's lots of antibiotics being used. And these are so-called hospital-associated MRSA, which are multi-drug resistant, which popped up in great number in the 1990s. These are restricted healthcare setting because they primarily encode these large antibiotic cassette, and they are taking a long time to double, so they don't compete well outside of the environment of a hospital. But then, in the late 1990s, a strain of MRSA popped up. This was the MMWR report from 1999 that announced that four children, previously healthy, never exposed to the healthcare setting, died of either sepsis or pneumonia. And this kind of sent a shockwave across the infectious disease world, because MRSA is supposed to be confined to the hospital. And in the subsequent 10 years or so, what we saw was quite amazing. MRSA became quite rampant in the community, such that by the mid-2000s or so, it accounted for about 50% of all outpatient strain that caused, Staph aureus strain that caused skin infection. So going from almost nowhere to causing about 50% of all skin infection out in the outpatient setting. So what do we know about this community-associated MRSA? In the US, it's actually dominated by primarily one single clone. It started off as a couple clone on the East Coast, USA 400, and on the West Coast, USA 300. But the USA 300 seemed to be so successful that it spread rapidly to become the primary single dominant clone across. And it is resistant to few antibiotics, and it contains a few potential virulence genes. And so as a strain that has fewer cassette, a smaller cassette, it seemed to be very successful in able to compete against the other MSSA staph aureus. This is a study that showed that USA 300 is a dominant clone. This is a study from ER across the US, across 11 of them, prospectively done, where they gather folks who have been infected with in the soft tissue, and they ask the question, how many of those who were infected in the soft tissue had MRSA or overall? And they found that overall, 80% had staph aureus, 60% of all of them are MRSA, and these one are pretty much all USA 300. So what do we know about USA 300 and the community-associated MRSA? They're associated with more severe diseases, not all of them, but some of them. For example, since the advent of these USA 300, we've seen increasing cases of myositis, what we used to call tropical myositis because we find it primarily elsewhere. But now we're seeing it quite a few of them in association a lot of time with bone infection. We see necrotizing pneumonia, so-called on X-ray, having a hole in the chest X-ray, which sometimes folks call these are necrotizing pneumonia, but we don't see that much before. We also see much more severe osteomyelitis, as we talked before. And in cases, in the last case, we see flesh-eating disease, such as necrotizing fasciitis, which is not in the past associated with MRSA or staph aureus. These were associated with strep and other, but nowadays staph aureus is causing necrotizing fasciitis. So obviously the strain itself is somehow different and seem to be causing a new range of disease that are more severe. Not all of them more severe, but occasionally you see these very severe strain diseases in the hospital, and those are a lot of time caused by this USA 300. Also accompanying this one is because of increased incidence of these MRSA overall, we have seen that MRSA is causing more morbidity and mortality. And this CDC study from Clevin from 2007 documented that there were more than 1.3 million cases of MRSA. There is estimation that if you count those ones that were not cultured, there's probably around 10 million or so, including the outpatient setting. There's 100,000 approximately invasive disease with about 20,000 deaths. And this was a report that documented that the MRSA of the infection with staph aureus has surpassed HIV in terms of death. So the question we were asking is, what caused this strain of USA 300 to come from nowhere to suddenly become one of the most prolific pathogen around? What is it about it that makes it so different? In terms of the question where it come from, folks still haven't found out exactly where it come from. There's some, it may have added a few genes, acquired a cassette, and from one of the older strain, but what is it, what confer property to it that make it so prolific? So if we were to analyze this one, we can look at a few possibility. First of all, there could be that the strain can survive better on fomite. And if it survive better, obviously they would transmit better and they cause more disease. They could transmit better, they can colonize better, and finally they can just be more pathogenic overall. So we start looking at each of these possibilities across the literature, and some of these questions we try to address in the lab. So first of all, the question about transmission and survival on fomite. And the transmission part is kind of obvious from lots of headline news where it was documented that there's MRSA breakout in school, and some of headline grabbing one were that there were MRSA outbreak within these football camp, within the St. Louis Ram training camp. And these, in these studies, they found that they found MRSA on razor blade, on some shoulder pad, some other material that caused transmission of these one. So at the time, one of ID fellow, many of you may know Rishi Desai, who is a CHLA fellow, who decided to tackle this study, and he was with Laura Miller and came to my lab, and together we performed this study. But all of this idea was conceived by Rishi, who is really, really smart. So what he did was he took a lot of these fomites that were surfaces that were documented in these outbreak study. He took some of these razor blade, towel, some soap, wood, but he also studied some Lego blocks and vinyl, and he took 1 million bacteria of either hospital-associated MRSA, community-associated MRSA, especially USA 300, and some of a normal MSSA strain. He only studied two of each because of how much he can do. But he plated those one, as you can see on these cutout pieces of these surfaces, and he coated these one and left them sit on those for a while and asked the question, how long do these survive on these surfaces? And can they transmit to, if you apply a pig skin on it for a, let's say, 5 seconds with constant pressure? And what he found was that pretty much survival and transmission goes hand in hand. But what's most interesting is the Lego pieces and the vinyl were the ones that retained these bacteria the longest, okay? And the number, in terms of number of bacteria, it went up from initially from 1 million and came down very quickly within the first week or two or so, from 1 million to about 100,000. And these ones then stay stable for over a week or so. And what he found was that for survival time, these community-associated MRSA USA 300 survive for 9 weeks or so. Those for hospital-associated MRSA survive for 2 weeks or less, and the MSSA tend to be variable. So imagine Lego blocks sitting there for many, many, with bacteria sitting there for many, many weeks. It's a good mode of transmission among children, obviously. So fomite can be a source of the rapid transmission of USA 300, but other possibility are colonization. And what do we know about colonization with USA 300? Well, USA 300, when the sequence of it was examined, it was found that it has a few unique genes, including PVL, which a toxin we'll talk about in a second. But another gene locus was, well, is fairly interesting, was something called ACME, or the arginine catabolic mobile element. And this one is a locus that has multiple property. It was found to be initially from staph epi, and it is believed to promote some colonization on the skin with staph epi by doing, perhaps increasing its tolerance to antimicrobial peptide on the skin or the pH. And so, interestingly, it's also one of a few that's only present in USA 300. So you can imagine that maybe this USA 300 has hijacked this gene that initially belonged to staph epi, and maybe it has taken it and allowed it to now survive better on the skin and elsewhere. Just like that, as depicted in the schematic over here. So is there any evidence to support that? Laura Miller, then from Harvard UCLA, went on to then do a study, a pretty interesting study, where he took a group of patients who are infected with community-associated MRSA, hospital-associated MRSA, or regular MSSA. And he asked, in these patients, what percentage of them are colonized in the axilla, in the inguinal area, in the rectum, or in the nose with these ones? Their nasal colonization rate were probably similar, but what they found was that with community-associated MRSA, the colonization rate outside of a nose was much higher at 8, 20, and 15% here compared to the MSSA and the old-fashioned hospital-associated MRSA, which were only at 3%. So you see a trend of these MRSA now coming out on the skin instead of being sticking to the surface of a nose only. There's another study. This is by Bindi from Chip Chambers lab at also in San Francisco. And we did study at UCSF and in San Francisco and in Boston. And he found an interesting trend that ever since the epidemic of MRSA, the number of people, men who have sex with men, have increased incidence of MRSA infection, which is they think is probably due to the sexual practice. And because and this was pointed out to potentially cause increased rectal or GI colonization that caused this to be increased overall. So these are the evidence that perhaps this USA 300 has acquired a new niche instead of just the nose itself. And this may, again, increase the likelihood that it would spread and also cause disease. Finally, what is the evidence about increased pathogenicities we talk about with USA 300? Well, the gene that was found in USA 300 that caused a lot of excitement is one that's called pentavalentine leukocytin. This is a toxin that was present in an epidemic clone of Staph aureus in the 1950s in the 8081 strain, and this caused a lot of havoc around that time. But it disappeared for a while and then reappeared in multiple clones in addition to USA 300 around the 1990s or so, including some European strain. And what it was found through these epidemic study was that these PVL toxin is associated with myositis, necrotizing pneumonia, more severe osteomyelitis, and lots of skin abscesses. So there was a lot of excitement for a while that people thought pentavalentine leukocytin is probably the factor responsible for lots of these increased severity of the MRSA infection. This pentavalentine leukocytin is a two-component toxin that lyses neutrophil, and it's thought that by lysing neutrophil, it causes this necrosis in the lung or on the surface of the skin. And when this first study appeared in Science in 2007, most people thought this is it, that pentavalentine leukocytin is the key to the whole dilemma about enigma surrounding the USA 300. But what was problematic was this study was not quite reproducible after it was published. Lots of study with mouse were done, and there was lots of them that claimed that this could never happen. We did this study, and we found that we needed about 100-fold increase in inoculum in order to get any effect at all. So overall, mouse itself, the effect wasn't very good. So folks decided to ask a question, if not the mouse, what about other animal model? So they tried the rat, the rabbit, primate, etc. And a lot of them had no effect, or some show some effect, but not in other models. And what's consistent across all of these models is that you require lots higher inoculum to cause the infection and for the PVL effect to be seen. So because of that, there was not a lot of agreement as to the role of PVL. Is it really a marker for disease severity, or is it really a cause of this increased severity in some of these diseases? Or are you going to believe a rat, the mouse, the baboon, or the rabbit? Which one animal are you going to take and believe your data? So based on that, a study came up last year that showed that this could be explained by the fact that this PVL toxin has affinity for receptor that's called C5A receptor, a complement receptor. It's only specific primarily for human C5A, and to a certain degree to the rabbit C5A, but not to the mouse, not to the monkey, et cetera. So this may explain the fact that we're using the wrong model to study this important factor overall. So what we decided to do is we decided to take a mouse rat, and humanize it using an established model. So what we did was we take a mouse, we added in stem cell from human, from cord blood, and we reconstitute it so that you start developing a functional human innate and adaptive immune system. And this is a picture that shows that these yellow dots are human cell that have reconstituted over 12 weeks or so. And when we did that, the first thing we noticed was, my God, these mice are so much more susceptible to Staph aureus infection. They require about 100-fold lower inoculum to cause an infection. Again, showing the mouse model itself is a little bit artificial overall. This could be explained from the fact that the mouse itself is not normally colonized with staph aureus, and so they don't see it, so they shouldn't recognize it so well. That's why the dose required is much higher, evolutionarily speaking. So what happened when you take these mice and infect it with strain that has PVL or isogenic strain that does not? Now you see that in the regular mouse, you don't see any difference in PVL, but in these knockout mouse, humanized mouse, what you see is PVL causes about 5 to 7-fold higher skin lesion size compared to the knockout. You can do the same by simply taking this immunocompromised mouse and take neutrophil from any individual, inject those neutrophil very transiently, and then infect them right away and see what happens. And as you can see, the neutrophil probably got lysed by these PVL, and they definitely cause a bigger lesion here compared to the PVL knockout. So this shows that PVL probably is a virulence factor overall for human. So far, what I've shown you is that reason why USA 300 may be so prolific overall in causing so much diseases compared to its other MSSA counterpart. Some reason include the fact that they can stick around fomite longer, they can probably colonize better in surfaces we haven't seen before, including the GI tract and the skin surface, and also they probably cause a bit more disease compared to their normal counterpart. So, the question is, what are the consequences of MRSA epidemic? Well, the consequence of MRSA epidemic is that we have more cases of MRSA, so we're using vancomycin empirically much more compared to before. And as a result of this one, we have potentially increased in resistance also. And we've also seen some increased treatment failure overall. The cause of these treatment failures are probably threefold. One of them could be some of these cases that are more severe, but that's probably a minor one. The two main reasons are probably because beta-lactamase is a better antibiotic, which we use primarily to treat staph aureus infection. Vancomycin is not so good. Also, the second reason is we've been seeing a little bit increased resistance to vancomycin, which I will come back to in a second. So vancomycin, as we know, compared to the beta-lactam drug, is a really bulky antibiotic. As you can see, the size of this compared to methicillin here. They're less effective overall at killing staph aureus in vitro. If you have a high inoculum of staph aureus in a person, they don't kill as well. They have problem penetrating into tissue like the lung and the CNS. And because of that, there's a few reports that show that they're associated with longer hospital stay and increased mortality. And in terms of because of these vancomycin increase use of vancomycin, this is a report from UCLA, but also replicated by other center. There's been some trend where the vancomycin MIC has been increasing in terms of resistance rate. So what you see is in this study, the number of strain of staph aureus that are resistant to vancomycin, the MIC going up from 1 to 2 has gone up over time. So most of them, the MIC goes up to 2 and stop. But the number of strain that has increased MICs definitely has gone up in quite a few medical centers. But not all, I might add. Some centers do not report this at all. But overall, if you look at the 16 to 20 or some report that's been done, there are many, many centers that have reported that overall, the vancomycin MIC has gone up over the years. And does this have any consequence? Mostly in adults, it seemed to have some consequence. And what they have shown in lots of these studies that you've seen, that this is a meta-analysis, is that if you have an MIC between 1.5 to 2, which, mind you, on the susceptibility scale, it will be, say, susceptible when you look at on your microbe in the lab when it's returned to you. These have causes lots of cases of treatment failure and increased mortality, as you can see from these bars over here. So even within the susceptible range, a lot of these vancomycin failure have been documented. And these are documented primarily in sepsis cases and some cases pneumonia. So this has led some of the experts, especially in the staph field, to come and even declare that vancomycin is entering obsolescence. There's lots of debate on that. They state that there's it will be a problem for these vancomycin to be able to treat effectively when once a lot of these strain comes out and become more resistant. And we're not talking about VRSA, which is not really a problem. But so alarmed by this, the National Research Council over the year have tried to address the need for new antibiotic. But not only by staph aureus, but a lot of these new strain of gram-negative bacteria that seem to be resistant to almost all antibiotic. Because of these increased resistance, they said that antibiotic resistances inevitable, and we must have new strategy of not just screening for new drug, because that seems to be not very effective, and we need new different approaches. So what they recommended was that we screen and not only continue screen for new antibiotic, but we have a little bit of different strategy, such as targeting some bacterial virulence factor, also targeting some host factors, and also maybe use some of these probiotic overall, just like in C. difficile. So for the rest of the talk, I'll give you a few examples from the lab of what we've done to illustrate these new strategies that's been done. This is what we do in a lab. We study innate immune system, adaptive immune system, and how they can combat the pathogen, and the outcome of whether we get better or not is by if the innate immune system is stronger than the pathogen. So the first strategy consists of weakening the defense of a pathogen. So in order to do that, we must first able to find the important virulence factor that the pathogen make to contribute to pathogenesis. And so if we find those one and we can neutralize these one, we can find a way of getting the bacteria more under control. One of the virulence factor we found quite a few years ago now is something called the golden pigments for staph aureus. Golden pigment as is aureus. Aureus in Latin means golden. So the golden part of the staph aureus actually is a carotenoid, just like in carrot, similar to carrot. They are known as antioxidant. So we thought that since neutrophil macrophages kill a lot of the pathogen using oxygen, maybe the role of these golden pigment is to neutralize these ones. So we went about and knocked out this gene from this pigment, from the staph aureus, and you made a white staph aureus out of this, okay? So once you make the white staph aureus, you ask the question, are they as susceptible as the golden pigment to oxidative killing, just as by singlet oxygen or hydrogen peroxide? And the answer is they're much more susceptible to these compared to the pigment strain. And if you add these one to blood killing consisting of primarily neutrophil kill these white strain a lot better than the golden strain. But if you take the blood from a CGD patient who do not have oxidative burst, the killing is the same here. And you can see this in mice that have wild type mice and CGD reactive oxygen species knockout, that there's a big difference in skin lesion here between the golden pigmented staph versus white pigmented one, and this difference goes away when this oxidative burst is absent. So we have established that the pigment is virulence factor, so how do you go about blocking this one? It turned out that we found a pathway here where the human cholesterol gene synthesis, as you can see here, intersected the biosynthesis of a golden pigment at the initial step. So what we thought was, if the initial synthesis step for the golden pigment and the human cholesterol is the same, perhaps you can use these inhibitor of these initial step and block it, and use that as a way to treat staph aureus disease. And indeed, there were lots of experimental inhibitors that block the human squalene synthase as a first gene. As an example, you take this gene from CRTM, which is the gene that encodes the first step for golden pigment biosynthesis, and look at its crystal structure compared to that of a human squalene synthase for the cholesterol. They're almost superimposable. And on top of that, you can crystallize a lot of inhibitor in it, and they work pretty well. And if you add this human cholesterol inhibitor to the staph, they lose their pigment over time, as you can see, within a few hours. And then they also decrease the susceptibility to oxidant and increase their killing by human blood. And if you apply these cholesterol inhibitor to the mouse, you can see that the mouse now is able to survive much better with staph aureus infection compared to the control. So this is one way this can be done in terms of trying to use a anti-virulence strategy. Another strategy I can talk about is the so-called hyaluronidase gene. That is a new strategy that we just found in the lab where bacteria are used to evade immune surveillance. Switching gear here, the host immune system is able to detect pathogen two way primarily. One way is they detect a lot of these components that are directly on the surface of these pathogens. They can also detect a lot of a pathogen whenever they cause tissue injury. And whenever there's tissue injury, tissue breakdown, the immune system is able to notice these changes in tissue and alert the whole immune system that something's happening that they must be alert to defend against it. And these are fundamental tenets of innate immunity brought about by Charlie Janeway and also Polly Metzinger. So one of the classic example of a dangerous signal is this hyaluronan, which is a matrix that's present in most tissues. And when this hyaluronan is broken down during tissue injury, they are further cut down by our own host hyaluronidase into pieces that are 4 to 16 mers. Okay? These are 4 to 16 mers hyaluronan fragment. And these are known to go and activate bind to toll-like receptor 2 and 4 to induce inflammation in these immune cells. So bacteria also make hyaluronidase. So we ask the question, if that's the case, if they need hyaluronidase to invade the host, well, how do they escape possibly this very elaborate immune system? So we found that actually in the literature, mammalian hyaluronidase that cut hyaluronan down, they cut it to the 4 to 16 mer, but the pathogen, staph aureus, strep pneumo, and GBS, for example, actually cut it strictly to one disaccharide. So the pieces are so much smaller that perhaps they don't activate immune system. So we hypothesized that these hyaluronidase actually from the pathogen evolved to really destroy the signal, so to make them inert. And indeed, that's what we found, that if we take feed these bigger pieces of hyaluronan to the bacterial hyaluronidase, they cut it down in size to a disaccharide only, and they cut down the inflammation down to almost a minimal level. And we are able to show that in vivo, this one protected the bacteria from a lot, so that promoting their survival. But what was also interesting is that the disaccharide they made over here, they're not inert. They on their own is able to inhibit further some of the LPS and LTA and other type of activation toll-like receptor. So as a result, even if you just add the disaccharide that's made from these pathogen and you add it to staph aureus or strep pneumo or Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, these cause decreased inflammation on its own, and these one can promote bacteria to survive better. So in other words, these bacteria were pretty clever. They're able to turn the system around, changing a surveillance system from the host into actually immune evasion system. And if we can block this one, this will be another strategy we can help the bacteria, help the host to fight the bacteria better. Okay, so now switching gear a bit, we just talked about targeting bacterial virulence factor. Now we're going to talk a little bit about what can we do to find factor to boost the host immune system. We can weaken the bacteria or we can boost the host immune system in this fight. But how do you go about finding something that boosts the immune system? The way we did it was we asked the question, are there immune deficiency syndrome that it makes the bacteria, the host, so weak that they cannot fight staph aureus? And if we find it, maybe they can provide us clue as to how to fight these infections better. So we study one of these condition called SGD, or specific granule deficiency, where these patients are extremely compromised. They get really severe staph aureus and pseudomonas infection. You look at their neutrophil, they lack expression of lots of these granules that's required to kill all of these bacteria, including cathelicidin, lactoferrin, et cetera. And the deficiency here is some gene called CBP epsilon, which is a transcription factor required for these neutrophil to make these granules overall. So if you take mice that are knocked out of these CBP epsilon, they cause some of the biggest lesion I've ever seen. You inject these mice with these bacteria, and they have lesion that erode almost through the skin all the way to the peritoneum, compared to usually more making a small lesion overall. Here's the formed lesion that's probably 5 to 10 times bigger compared to that of normal mouse. And of course, they cause a lot more, allow the bacteria to survive a lot better in these mice also. What happened here is these neutrophils are defective, and therefore they allow bacteria, in fact, to grow within the neutrophil. So we ask the question, if we know this information, what can we do about it to help us to fight Staph aureus overall? And so maybe if CBP epsilon is so important, maybe if we can find something that boosts CBP epsilon, we can find a way to fight infection. So first of all, we took cell, macrophage cell line, and we express CBP overall inside of these cell line. And we found that if you express this one, they kill Staph aureus about 30-fold better or so. And we looked at the literature and we saw that CBP epsilon is actually part of a family of CBP, for which one of these family members, CP alpha and beta, people know that nicotinamide or vitamin B3 can be used to increase its expression. The way it does it is it increase acetylation lysine on the histone, so it actually promotes increased expression of these. The way it works in detail is that the acetylation of its histone on the promoter region relaxes the chromatin, as you can see here, and by relaxing it, it allows a lot of the transcriptional machinery to reach it and allow it to transcribe a lot better down here. So what happened here is we looked at whether nicotinamide has an effect on CBP epsilon, and surely it does. It can actually bind to this histone residue by doing so, it increases transcription of several of these antimicrobial genes, including lactoferrin and antimicrobial peptide cathelicidin. And how does that translate into killing our bacteria? So we took human blood. Now we added this nicotinamide, which is vitamin B3 you can get from the store at 1 millimolar, which is a high dose compared to what we normally get. And if we add these one nicotinamide, pre-treat them for a while, and add these bacteria, they kill it by 100 and sometimes up to 1,000-fold better. Here's a plate that has nicotinamide prior, and this is one that doesn't. And nicotinamide at 1 millimolar does not kill the bacteria on its own. It depends on neutrophil killing. And you can then give a nicotinamide to the mice before the infection, after infection, and you found that they're effective both ways. And we also show that this is CBP epsilon dependent. And you can do the same with Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, to a lesser degree than Staph aureus, and also to some other bacterium to see that they actually improve clearance of bacteria. So this is another strategy where we found an immunodeficiency condition, and by trying to study it, we found a condition by which we can boost immune killing of bacteria, and they may help in trying to help us address the question of antibiotic resistance. Okay, deep breath, and the final thing I'm going to talk about today is not really yogurt, but probiotic approach. You probably heard about C. difficile and the stool transfer that's been made famous, but it can be applied in a way to Staph aureus also. So the thought is that we are always talking about MRSA colonization as a precursor to infection. People who are colonized with MRSA get Staph aureus infection a lot more. So, and the current protocol of putting mupirocin and maybe Pfizer Hex bath or bleach bath do not adequately provide long-term protection. After some 3, 6, or 9, 8 months or so, you're back to as if you didn't have that treatment before. So what we think is happening is that there is a niche competition between these bacteria in different parts, okay? In any type of setting, in the skin, in the nose, or elsewhere, there's usually competition with bacteria for getting a foothold on it. Whoever wins this war, they can get hold of this colonization spot, and they do not allow other bacteria to come in. So what was found was that from prior study was that Staph epi, certain type of Staph epi, and Corynae bacteria seem to compete against Staph aureus. Whenever you have one, you have less of the other, and vice versa. So the thought is, whenever you give somebody mupirocin, you're probably wiping out the nose overall, and you're also wiping out all the competitor. So what happened is, whoever come next first may colonize that person again. So we thought that if that's the case, perhaps but after putting mupirocin and you apply back some good bacteria, you can keep the MRSA out of this thing. So supporting this idea was that there's in a long time ago, maybe in 1960s or so, there's colonization, a trial that's been done in children, in fact, in infants. That what people are trying in those times was that there were lots of epidemics of Staph aureus. So folks developed a so-called, selected out a so-called non-pathogenic Staph aureus strain, which they applied to folks who were infected with Staph aureus. Even during infection. So the thought was the non-pathogenic strain will compete out this pathogenic strain and allow to help get rid of this infection. And it worked for the most part, except there was one or two child who didn't do so well, and so they canceled all the trial. But we thought maybe the same, you don't have to use a non-pathogenic or less pathogenic staff. You just use one of those bacteria that does normally colonize your nose and doesn't cause disease, and maybe you can do well. So as a proof of principle, you take somebody who, for example, who has Staph aureus infection, and you treat them with antibiotic, okay? And then you add it back either nothing or Staph epi, and then you ask if these, that's the case, when the MRSA come around, are they less likely to colonize the nose again? And we apply this one to the nose. And as you can see, the nasal MRSA, if you apply Staph epi after antibiotic treatment, is much less than that if you don't apply it. So it's kind of proof of principle that perhaps by replacing these benign strain, you can kick out the bacteria that causes colonization. One of our collaborators went one step further. They were able to do this in Japan, where they applied these Staph epi, one of the Staph epi strain, to the nose of volunteers or hospital worker, and they here are bacterial MRSA colonization on the first day, and they kept on adding these Staph epi strain to their nose over several days. And over time, these Staph epi colonized these folks, and they found that the Staph aureus disappear. They found that this is caused, to some strain that has a biofilm protease. But even further than that, what another study found from the same group in Japan was that if you have human volunteer who had this applied to them using coronary bacteria, these individuals seem to remain decolonized for 3 to 35 months whenever they came back and were available for study. So they seem to be successful in kicking out and maintaining decolonization in these few individuals for which they tried this trial. So overall, this is kind of an interesting thing that is experimental. I don't know if you'll ever get to the market, but nonetheless quite interesting. The summary for this one is that we have USA300 we talked about as a pretty interesting bug, which proliferated from nothing, that has all these properties that allow it to survive better outside, colonize better, and increase pathogenicity. And this is, strains such as this is causing increased antibiotic use and resistance. So I showed you a few examples of non-traditional way on which we can combat antibiotic resistance. With this, I would like to, these are the complementary approaches, attenuate bacterial virulence, boosting immune system using probiotic. And I want to acknowledge folks who have done this work, a lot of them, folks in my lab, Stacey, Kohler, Pierre, who did all of these hyaluronan and some of the vitamin B work, Dolores of the PVL work, and Bungu Park in terms of nasal colonization. Collaborator from Cedars, Phil Kessler, on the vitamin B3 work. Victor Nise, who did the golden pigment, who's my PI from before. Eric Oldfield from the cholesterol work, and Lauren with For My Study. Andrew Wong, who did the crystallography. Terrence Tan also with a humanized mouse. And Rishi, who did that really astute study on the For My. Thank you.